Hello everybody, welcome back to the Ninja Gaiden tutorial series. Now, for those of you who thought I'd forgot about this series, I hadn't. It has been a while since the last one. It's been a little over a month. I've been pretty busy with work as usual, but I actually had a minor injury, kind of messed my back up a little bit, which made sitting down very painful. So doing these videos takes just hours and hours in terms of commentary and post-production, so I wasn't able to do one, which was really annoying, because I did want to get this one out pretty quick. But back to him now. So this one's going to cover all the projectiles and all the Ninpo in the game. Now, you may be thinking, what's there to know about projectiles or Ninpo in the game? They're pretty straightforward, right? Well, if you do think that, this video is definitely for you. I'm just going to go down all the projectile weapons first and just briefly explain, you know, what they are and their basic function. So, you only ever start out with the default shurikens as your only projectile weapon. You get these at the start of the game. And the only really interesting thing to note about these is that they are unlimited. They're the only projectile in the game which are infinite. You don't have any limit to how many you can throw with these. God knows where Ryu keeps them all, but, you know, we don't need to know that, do we? So that's pretty much all there is to know about shurikens without getting into the mechanics of it. Incendiary shurikens you get relatively early on. You get these in Chapter 6. You get them in the monastery. You pick them up. If you pick up incendiary shurikens, sometimes you have them in boxes. You'll get a full stock of them. You can hold 15. And you can throw one at a time, or you can throw two, depending on your movement. I'll get into that in a minute. And the only really interesting thing to note about incendiary shurikens is they're really good for stunning, and they're also really good for setting up UTs. That's one of their primary functions. And they do a nice bit of damage. They're not really, really damaging. You know, you're not going to use them as like a primary way to actually kill an enemy. But they're very good for staggering enemies and taking them out of the equation, which is really nice. The Windmill Shuriken is next. This is actually the first extra shuriken you'll get, depending on what difficulty you're on. You usually get this in Tyron in Chapter 4 when you go and find the Xbox statue. And this is actually a really, really good weapon. It's not great in terms of damage, but it's really good for maneuverability and setting up UTs. And also, it's one of the best, if not the best, for avoiding accidental wall clings. And I'll get into that when I go through them. But this is actually a really good weapon. It's often underutilized in a lot of ways. It's kind of, I know when I first started playing the game and got the Windmill Shuriken, you think, well, that's kind of cool, but, you know, doesn't really do anything, and you know, the more you know, it's actually a very, very good weapon. The smoke bombs were introduced in the Hurricane Packs and Ninja Gaiden Black. I've been over smoke bombs a lot, but these are their primary use is for removing armor and defense on enemies. That is probably going to be the next video I do after this one, is going to be that one. That one probably will take a little bit longer though, so that might be a couple of weeks for that one. But I'll go through these as well, just to go over some basics of them. All the arrows function in a very similar fashion. The APF SDS cores have the biggest hitbox of all the arrows. I'll get into that in a second. And the explosive arrows also have a area of effect on them, which is really cool. When they impact, they give off fire, and that fire can actually hit enemies and damage them, and causes a little bit of damage. It doesn't do a lot of health damage to them, but it stuns them for ages, which is its most effective use. So that's just the basic outline of all the individual weapons. So I'm going to swap over to Ninpo now and just do the same thing. Firewheels, again, is the first Ninpo you get. You get this in Chapter 2 on every difficulty. Firewheels is really good for adding extra bits of damage on combos on enemies that don't move a lot. So, you know, like ogres, fiends, bosses, anything that doesn't get knocked away easily, firewheels are really great for. They're, of course, fantastic for ghostfish. Pretty much every Ninpo is great for ghostfish if you just want to be cheap and use Ninpo. But firewheels, just the biggest thing, obviously, is you can move while you have them on, is the best thing about firewheels. You know, you can actually move while using this Ninpo, and it's the only Ninpo you can do that with. So, Art of the Inferno is probably the most, I don't want to say versatile, because that might be Inazuma, but it's probably a toss-up, actually, between Inferno and Inazuma. Inferno Ninpo is the most powerful across the board. Ice Storm is more powerful against the Fireworm, but that's it. But other than that, Inferno Ninpo is the most powerful Ninpo in the game in terms of single hit. On level 3, this thing does a massive amount of damage, and much like the exploding arrows, it also has that area of effect that when the first when the fireball that Ryu throws out hits, I'll just showcase that real quick, actually. Level 3 takes a bit longer. But as you can see, when that impacts, there's that little ring that comes out. And that ring will also damage enemies. And, fun fact, it does the same amount of damage as the actual fireball itself. So there's no damage reduction there. The exploding arrows, the little effect that comes out of the exploding arrows doesn't do nearly as much damage as the actual impact of the exploding arrow, whereas Inferno Ninpo is just as powerful. You'll see it a lot on Karma runs, but more often than not, this Inferno Ninpo is left at level 2. The reason it's left at level 2 is because the animation for level 2 is the same as level 1, but it is substantially more powerful, and you get that area of effect, so you don't really need the level 3. The level 3 upgrade for Inferno is completely overkill. You don't need it, but it's just nice to have it. Ice Storm is next. Ice Storm is probably the least useful of all the Ninpos. It's really not that great, and it's really only ever good on level 3. As you can see by the rings on the floor, its area of effect is massive, but unfortunately, it doesn't really suck enemies in. Which is something that I just kind of wish it did. It seems like it should do that. It's really good if you are in a bind and you just need something to get you out. It does really good damage to enemies that don't get knocked out of it. You'll find that man-sized enemies like ninjas and, you know, fiends and samurai, it will kind of spin them up, kind of like a tornado, but then they'll get tossed out of it. Whereas enemies that don't do that, enemies that can't be juggled, for example, like, you know, fiends or ogres or crab fiends, although it can juggle laser crab fiends, even though they can technically be launched, they will just get stun locked in it, and they'll just take hit after hit after hit after hit, and it's actually quite powerful at level 3, so that's something to bear in mind. And last but not least is Inazuma. Again, kind of tied with Inferno for the most versatile. Inazuma's really, really good. Level 1 and 2, it's extremely fast, as you can see. It doesn't take a long time to do it. The initial activation of it will hit people. Inferno will do that as well, as pretty much every Ninpo does. And well, the great thing about Inazuma is that it will track however many enemies are on screen. It doesn't matter how many enemies that are on screen, whether it's 1 or 20, Inazuma will hit every single one of them. And it also has a really cool area of stun effect on level 1 and 2 on Alma and Nikkei and Awakened Alma. I'll put different footage up of that so you can see it. But on level 1 and 2, you'll often get the initial, you know, explosion of the Ninpo, and then after that they'll get knocked down. That doesn't happen with level 3 Inazuma. That's why, if you've ever seen any comp, it's very common to see the Inazuma stay at level 2 and Inferno level 2. You don't really see, you know, kind of newer Karma runs use level 3 Ninpo, as in terms of Karma it doesn't give you any bonus, because all it does is do more damage, and Ninpo on a Karma run is a tool as opposed to kind of a method of attack. You know, it's more versatile to get UTs out of it. That's the basic rundown of all the Ninpos and all the projectiles. So now I'm going to get into a bit more information about them. The shurikens are fairly straightforward. The shuriken's primary use is just cancelling attacks. As you can see, it's really easy to just cancel attacks with you know, shuriken inputs. This doesn't really have that much of an impact on the game. It's just something that's really easy to do, and it's helpful in a couple of bosses. You'll have seen me do it a lot. I'm a big fan of XXY Shuriken Cancel Forward Y launchers on Nikkei. It does a ton of damage, and it's really cool. I also love this XX Forward X Shuriken Cancel. The reason I do that, it's one of those things I do just because I think it looks really cool, but B, you'll have noticed if you've seen me do it, this hit right here in the Dragon Swords XX Forward X string, I believe I mentioned it in the weapon tutorial, but it has a insane amount of hit advantage. When you hit an enemy with this, as you can see, if I let that move end and then move, it takes a while for me to be able to move after that. So there's the stab and I'm moving away. If I do that move and end it in a shuriken, I can move instantly, or I can jump, or I can use Ninpo, or I can wind run. You know, the world's my oyster at that. Whereas if I just let this hit and block, I'm left at, you know, my advantage is gone by the time I regain control of Ryu. So shuriken cancelling is really good. That leads me to my next point, actually. Shurikens have a lot of priority over enemies. Now, what I mean by priority is, if you've ever played a fighting game, you'll know that some moves have priority over others. So, for example, air shurikens are a really good use of this. They will take priority over an other enemy's animation. So, for example, if you roll jump and throw shurikens, you will knock enemies out of their animations. This is really good on Evil Ryu in certain instances, because if he gets to a point where you're on higher ground and he's trying to chase you, you can knock him down with a single shuriken, because it has more priority than his jump, which is really cool. That's about it for shurikens. Trying to think if there's anything I've missed. Running shurikens are really good for stopping stuff chasing you. If you're new to the game, if you're having trouble roll jumping, or you know, roll jumping in different directions and you know, doing the on landing jumps, if this is a little bit too complicated to kind of get away from enemies, just running and tossing shurikens. Ryu will auto target the enemies behind him, and again, shurikens on hit are really, really advantageous, so it will slow down enemies pursuing you. So I think that's about it for shurikens. Last thing, I probably mentioned this before, but one of the best things about regular shurikens is they're a great way to cancel the recovery of a flying swallow. As you can see, if I just let a flying swallow whiff like that, it takes ages for me to recover. Look how long that takes for me to start. I'm just holding forward on the stick here, so that's how long it takes me to move. If I do a flying swallow and then cancel into shurikens, I'm able to move way faster than doing that. So, incendiary shurikens now. Function largely in the same way. You can still cancel. Pretty much anything can be projectile cancelled if it's a shuriken, whether it's in air or on the ground. The main reason that the incendiaries aren't as effective is, as you can see, the actual animation is a lot slower. Ryu kind of has to get it ready. So that's one downside of incendiary shurikens. A plus side to them is, though, that they are a lot more powerful, and they stun enemies really well. If you get an enemy with zero armor or defense and you hit him with an incendiary shuriken, he will be stunned long enough sometimes for you to charge a full UT without celerity equipped. So that's a really good way to get bonus essence out of a last enemy in an encounter if you need it. So that's something that's always useful to use. One thing to note about incendiary shurikens is there are certain enemies that are immune to them. Most bosses are, I think, Pazu, Hydrocubus. Who else is there? Pazu, Hydrocubus. Pretty much any boss that's fleshy, if that makes sense. Any boss that hasn't got armor on, so you know, like Doku, tanks, armor, all that stuff, they're going to all be immune to incendiary shurikens, so they're not going to work. The armored soldiers, armored commandos, they don't work on them. They don't work on fiends, they don't work on ogres. So yeah, basically squishy enemies, for lack of a better phrase. They only work on the squishies. But they're really good for that. They do add a nice bit of damage, and they're also good for cancelling air combos if you ever need to. The one use of them as well is, as you can kind of see when you throw an incendiary shuriken, I'll just jump here. So, as you can see, I'm reaching kind of just above the, like, like a third way up that roof. I'll just zoom in with the bow here a second. So as you can see, when I jump, the tip of Ryu's head is getting to about there, where that arrow is, okay? So I'm jumping like that. When you jump with the incendiaries and you start the throw of an incendiary shuriken, you can kind of see how much higher Ryu goes. It does make you travel a little bit. I'll get back to where I was. So you can kind of see he gains a little bit of height, and that's one of the main ways in which these are used for shortcuts. As you can see, when you jump forward, start the animation, and then do the helm splitter, not only do you save your shuriken because you don't actually throw it, you cancel that animation, you can get a little bit of extra height and distance with your jump. That also works for regular shurikens. You just gain a little bit more extra height with the incendiary. It's not substantial. It's just a fraction more height. One way to really showcase that is if you go and look at the video I made for the shortcut in Chapter 9, where you skip the warehouse. Doing that with incendiary shurikens is just a little bit easier because of that little bit extra height you get. So it's just something to note. That's primarily used with air destruction slash BY. It's one of the best kind of distance coverers and delays in air. That's one thing to note. And that's pretty much it for incendiary shurikens. There's a couple of very particular uses. Eternal Legend, they're really good for guaranteeing a UT on Masakado. Eternal Legend can be a quite tough mission when you're new to the game, and killing Masakado with a UT gets you a ton of essence, which makes the start of Eternal Legend a little bit easier. So that's something to take advantage of. They're also really good against clone Ryus, as I've shown before. Getting UTs on clone Ryus is really, really good. They're also good for buffing up UF combos. For example, a common thing you'll see with the UF is if you do XY and then just do on landing like that, you can actually cancel into an incendiary after that move and then still do your on landing rotate Y. It gives you a little bit extra damage. Not a big deal, but it's just nice to have a little bit of extra damage wherever possible. So moving on now to the Windmill Shuriken. Now, the reason I really like the Windmill Shuriken is because it's the best one for avoiding wall clings when you don't want them. So, for example, if you're in close quarters, this isn't the best place to show it, but I'll just do this near a wall. If you want to do a UT and you're at this kind of angle, and let's say there's an enemy right in front of me right now, and there's an enemy to reuse left. My only viable option here is to jump away from the kind of lower quarter of the screen. So when I do that, I'm going to get a warkling, and I obviously don't want that. In warklings, you're vulnerable, and you can be knocked out of your animation, so you don't want that. So if you want to do a roll jump with the Windmill Shuriken, you can just throw that. Ryu will also always auto-target the enemies, so that will, when you land, I can't show that here, but if there was an enemy in front of me right now, I'm jumping backwards, but Ryu will throw the shuriken towards the enemy, so that when I land, I'm actually facing the enemy with my on-landing, like this. So there's a very small chance of your on-landing UT hitting, missing. And the reason I like the Windmill Shuriken is because it's just the quickest way of doing it. As you can see, that is a very, very short amount of time to delay being in the air. Whereas if you use the incendiary, if you let it go, as you can see, it's a little bit longer. You can't cancel this animation, the in-air throw, and do an on-landing. So if I cancel it, I do my helm splitter. You can't cancel it into air destruction slash either. So you have to let the throw go and then do your on-landing. That takes longer. And of course, shurikens are more or less the same. So that's why I like the Windmill Shuriken for that. If you're ever in a situation where you need to not get warklings and screw up your on-landing UTs, I highly recommend using the Windmill Shuriken. It's really good. Much like the Incendiary is Shuriken 2, the Windmill Shuriken won't hit armor. It won't go through armor. So squishies only for the Windmill Shuriken. And that's a really good way to stop getting accidental warklings and messing up your UT chains. It's also really good for Hydra Cubus on his tentacles. It does the most damage to his tentacles. It's very good for that. So, smoke bombs. I've talked about smoke bombs a lot throughout these videos. Smoke bombs are mainly used, as I said, for removing armor and defense. If you've got an enemy like the Cat Fiends or the Ninjas on the high difficulties, they have very high defense, so you won't be able to just run up to them and do forward Y, for example. If you have a smoke bomb out, you can smoke bomb, get around them, forward Y, piece of cake, they won't block it, they won't evade it. Samurai is an example of an enemy that's got really high defense, as are the Black Captain guys on the Commandos. The soldiers too, actually, now that I think about it. And the Commando Fiends, they have really high defense too. Armor, sorry, not defense. Defense is when an enemy will evade you, as in, you know, not block. Armor is when they will just block your attack and counter you. So, but again, I'll cover that more in depth in other videos. The only really cool thing to note about smoke bombs, I've mentioned it before, but the roll animation does have invulnerability frames, so you can chain rolls together like that. It's really, really good. You can also redirect the rolls, so you can roll one way, smoke bomb the other way, roll one way, smoke bomb the other way, roll one way, jump, smoke bomb, do that. You can also chain a roll from, a windmill slash from a smoke bomb, like that. And then you can cancel that into rolls. I've talked about that before. So you can actually do, you can chain three rolls together. You can do a roll, smoke bomb, windmill slash, which I just think looks kind of cool. You can also do it either way. You can redirect all of those as well. So I'll just do that here. So I'll roll to the right, smoke bomb to the left, and then windmill slash to the right. So roll to the right, smoke to the left, windmill to the right. It's a really good way of just confusing enemies. For example, when you do something like that, if you do a smoke bomb and then windmill slash directly through that smoke bomb, there's a very, very small fraction of time where your enemy can actually interrupt that, because you're in iframes pretty much throughout that entire thing. So that's just something that's really, really fun to do, and it's actually very, very effective, and it's very satisfying to do. It's really fun to do triple rolls like that. Just looks really cool. So that's pretty much it for smoke bombs. I'll get into those more in the armor and defense video, which will follow this. So arrows. Arrows are really straightforward. Ryu's auto-targeting with arrows is absolute rubbish. It's terrible. He'll always target, you know, a star or something over whatever you're trying to hit. So generally speaking, wherever possible, try not to use just, you know, the regular B, you know, holding down B for shooting arrows, as Ryu is pretty stupid and he'll probably miss whatever you're shooting at. Sometimes you can't really avoid doing that though, like for tanks on a karma run, you kind of have to use arrows, and that's pretty much it. As you can see by you can kind of see that effect that comes off the arrows. I'll slow this down so you can actually see it in slow motion, but you'll see these like rings that come off the arrow. That basically denotes the arrow's hitbox, and as you can see, the APF SDS scores have got the biggest hitbox, but when explosive arrows hit an enemy, as you can see, they give off that little explosion, and as I said, that can damage enemies and can stun them, which is really helpful. And it also has an insane amount of active frames, by the way. That fire effect is active for at least a few frames after it's completely gone. Sometimes you'll see it if you're just using arrows in regular combat. You'll see an enemy like walk past where you just shot an arrow, and even though there's nothing there, he'll just catch on fire, which looks really cool, and it just looks like he's spontaneously combusted. But it just looks really funny to see an enemy walk past where you just shot and just all of a sudden he's on fire and he falls over. It's a pretty funny effect. The one thing to note about arrows, really quickly, is that this is actually the fastest way to shoot them, is by auto-aiming, which is annoying. As you can see, if I'm in first-person mode, it's actually a little bit slower to shoot consecutive arrows, or if I'm just like stood here just pressing B. You can hold down your arrows and delay them. I'm just tapping B to shoot them really quickly, but you can just, if you hold down the arrow, hold down B, you'll just hold the arrow out, and Ryu will be, you know, completely still while pulling the arrow. This is a great way if you ever want to set up an arrow shot for whatever reason. And you can even move the camera around while you've got the bow hold down, which is kind of cool. And as soon as you move the left stick, then you will go into first person view. Now, going into first person view is the main thing I want to talk about with the arrows, as you can see, there's no crosshair. So you have to know where these arrows are going to hit. However, they will hit, if you don't move, they will hit the same bit every single time, if you don't move. There's no bloom or anything like that. As you can see, they hit the same mark every single time. Go up here. As you can see, there we are. Robin Hood, eat your heart out. You got nothing. You got nothing on me. So that's one thing to note about the first person view. Now, that's something that is just going to take practice. Early on when the game was out, like being accurate with arrows was definitely something that people commented on a lot. Like, you know, how do you be accurate with arrows? Like, how do you know? It really is just practice. Practice makes perfect. Just keep playing, keep practicing, and you will get it eventually. One kind of like secret information, I guess, to say. Sometimes it can be confusing when you see arrows used really effectively. It can look like the person is just a really good shot when all they're actually doing is predicting where the enemy goes. For example, if you watch any speed run of the helicopter being killed, then you can, you know, every arrow will hit all the time. So every arrow hits every single time, but all they're really doing is they know where that helicopter's going to go. So they're not strictly aiming as such. You know, they know where the helicopter's going. So, for example, if you were to imagine the helicopter is, you know, I'm aiming at him right now, then you can track where he's going to move, and he's not going to be able to evade the shot. So that's something that can, it can look like someone's really accurate, but, you know, they know what's coming. So it can make them look a bit better than they actually are. So that's pretty much it for arrows. They're fairly straightforward. They're very much a utility weapon. They're really good for the Emperor second form with the skulls. Having a good, you know, stock of arrows is really good. Inazuma is also really good for that, but arrows just lets you, you know, stay back and keep nice and safe. They're also really good for laser crab fiends, or exploding arrows are really good for them, sorry. Laser crab fiends can be quite tricky to fight without Ninpo or UTs or anything like that, but exploding arrows actually do a really nice chunk of damage to laser crab fiends, and they also stun them, which is really cool. You do have to be careful though, as again, when you're aiming automatically, Ryu can miss, and then if you miss, you're going to get hit, so, you know, use with caution. One thing to note about smoke bombs and incendiaries. Oh, I've ran out. I need to go buy some more. I'll edit this out. Okay, we're back. Okay, I went shopping. I bought some more incendiaries and smoke bombs, as I wanted to cover the last thing, the last intricate thing really regarding projectiles and your Ninpo. When you have projectiles that take effect after a certain amount of time, for example, the shurikens, I can pause before that shuriken explodes. Like so. So if you use an incendiary shuriken, but then swap projectiles, it actually cancels the shuriken you just threw, but you still lose the shuriken. As you can see, I've got 13 here. So go into my item screen, swap, it's gone. I don't actually get the explosion. So be careful if you, for example, put an incendiary in someone and then think, oh, I'm going to swap to my smoke bombs now. That incendiary shuriken won't explode. And it's the same with the smoke bombs. If you smoke bomb, not smoke bomb, sorry. No, it is smoke bombs. It's been a while. I apologize. If you do a smoke bomb and then for whatever reason think, oh, I need to swap. If you actually go into your item screen before it explodes, the smoke bomb doesn't actually explode, but you still lose the smoke bomb. So make sure the smoke bomb has actually gone off before you change projectile weapon. You're never really going to need to use that, but it's just something to bear in mind, as it can catch you out if you're not careful. If you can, you know, say for example, if you stun an enemy with an incendiary and then think, right, okay, it's arrow time, and then you go away, and then that projectile's gone, you think, oh crap, you know, that enemy can now hit me. So that's pretty much it for projectiles. One last thing to note, actually I forgot to mention it in incendiaries. If you throw incendiaries while in a bird flip, Ryu will actually throw two. So it doesn't matter what kind of flip it is, as long as you flip off a wall, it can be, you know, the vertical flip, it can be a horizontal one. You won't get it off of a wall run. A wall run will just give you the final one, but if you get a wall cling like that and then flip off, you'll throw two. You can stop it after one. You can throw one and cancel it in between, which is really helpful. This is also a really good way to evade projectiles in the mission modes where you fight Nikkei. It's really good to just do a flying bird flip, throw two incendiaries, and then do your helm splitter. If you only have one left, you'll get the same animation. You'll just only throw one incendiary shuriken. So just keep that in mind. So let's get back to Ninpo. The last thing to note about Ninpo is what I talked about just now with pausing the game. If you, for example, activate firewheels, you can actually cancel this. Not a lot of people seem to know about this, but if you just let firewheels go like this, you have to let that run out before you can do another one. And one of the best things about firewheels is the amount of invulnerability that initial activation gives you. So, for example, in Fiend Mirai, where you want to abuse the low health UF, you've probably seen it on a calm run. You might have even seen it on one of mine. But you'll see you go into firewheels. So let's say, for example, I'm going to let this run out and then I'll do it to showcase how it works. So you got a full stock of Ninpo and you want to abuse forward Ys on him. So you can do forward Y and then you can go into your item screen, equip Inferno, and this cancels your firewheels. Forward Y, do it again. Just do it. You don't have to equip Inferno. You can equip, you know, you can equip whatever Ninpo you want. Forward Y, go back. Equip ice, you know, equip whatever you want, forward Y. Don't forget to swap back to your Ninpo, or otherwise this happens. So that's just a nice little trick you can do with firewheels. It's very, very specific, though. Fiend Mirai is about the best example of that being useful, I can think of right now. Otherwise, it's just a neat little trick. For example, if you're doing a firewheels on Ghostfish, say, and you don't want to kill all the Ghostfish with it, you want to cancel your firewheels, you can just do firewheels, say for example, you know, get your UT out if you're on a calm run or something, and then you can carry on and you don't have to worry about killing all the fish when you don't want to. So that's pretty much it, guys. This video was a bit long, although there's a lot of intricacies to these two things, and they don't really give you a whole lot of information. I mean, for example, if you go into the item screen, like the descriptions for Ninpo are really, really bad. I mean, look, that basically, you can throw a fireball. Doesn't really show you, like, what it can do. In Azumarill especially. Likewise with the shurikens, it doesn't really show you, like, you know, or tell you, like, what they're really effective against. In hindsight, this could have probably been two videos, but hopefully you guys don't mind. Armor and Defense is going to be next. And hopefully I'll be able to get that done within a week or so. I apologize, this video has been a lot of talking, that there's not really a lot. I included examples for pretty much everything I could think of, but a lot of it is pretty self-explanatory. You know, this was a pretty talk-heavy video. But the next one will be full of extra footage. So look forward to that, I guess. So anyway, guys, thanks for watching, and I will see you in the next video. Take care.